That's good. My mom is in from Florida to cool weather, but not colds, you know what I'm saying? But it's all good, and good to have the Rakes back with us. Let's thank the Lord for watching over them. They just got back from Pensacola, Florida, and just endured the Hurricane Sally in an RV. And we as a church, Matt and deacons and our staff have been praying for them. Some of you have been praying for them, and they're grateful, and we're just glad to have you all back. It was quite an ordeal they've been through. And welcome. We've got several first-time guests with us today. It's so good to have you. I want to welcome those joining us online today. Let me just say a word. We have children and youth here. Let's thank the Lord for that this morning. And I just want you to know, be comfortable. If you need to get up, if they spill something, don't worry about it. If you need to get up and move around, we just love kids here, and glad that to have you all with us today. But well, my name is Pastor Michael, and I'm just excited about today. We're looking forward to our time of worship, and in just a minute, the words will be on the screen, and Keegan and our praise team is going to lead you in that. But before we do anything else, let's just pause and go to Him in prayer. Amen. Let's bow and let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for today. We thank you for just being a God who cares. Lord, you care about our praises. You care about our worries. You care about everything in between. Lord, you're the God of the mountains and you're the God of the valleys. And so whatever we're experiencing today, Lord, we can look to you. I thank you for your word that reminds us of truth. And Lord, may we just focus in on truth today, and in particular the person of truth, and that's you, Jesus. I pray you'd illuminate and enlighten our hearts this morning. And God, just let us hear from you and just experience you in a real and tangible way. Lord, we love you. We bless your name. We thank you, Lord, that you loved us so much that even while we were yet sinners, you died on the cross for us. And God, that's reason to praise today. You rose again on the third day and conquered death and was the down payment for our sins. And we're just grateful for that here, even now, 2,000 years later. Lord, may you be pleased with us. May you be honored today in everything that we sing, think, say, do. And even when we respond at the end of today, Lord, may we just focus in on you. And we love you. Just again, may you be glorified, we pray now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's stand and worship together. The word of the Lord says in Ephesians 1, verse 18, I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened, so that you will know what is the hope of his calling. What are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints? Let's sing together. Open the eyes of my heart.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart, I want to see you, I want to see you,
to see you high,
see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory, pour out your power and love, as we sing holy, holy, holy,
see
you high and lifted up. Shining in the light of your glory, pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see.
You may be seated. Kevin's coming in just a second here to give some announcements, but we want to just quickly, we've got a couple of baptism certificates to hand out, and we've had the privilege to baptize, I think, five in the last month or so, but let's praise the Lord for that today. I'm so thankful. Of course, we know the baptism doesn't save you. It's just an outward expression of what Jesus did on the inside, but it's our first step of obedience. And if you have made a decision to follow the Lord and trusted in Him, but never followed in believer's baptism, we'd love to do that. If you want to talk to me after the service, or any one of our staff or deacons, we'd be glad to help you with that. But where's Adriana and Emily? Why don't y'all come up here, Miss Susan? And it was last month that these two came and followed a believer's baptism. Both of them, friends, almost like sisters, aren't you? Kind of like just sisters. And now they're sisters in Christ. Amen. Oh, that was good. I like that. they came to our youth that we have on Sunday nights from 5:30 to 8:30, and they were feeling the Lord tugging on their heart and convicted of their sins and prayed and repented and trusted in Him. And so with that, Emily Smith, here is your certificate. Congratulations. And also Adriana Easter. Congratulations. Look right there. Thank you. You may be seated. Kevin?
Well, good morning, everyone. Good morning. Just like to welcome everyone, members, guests. I'm glad to have everyone here this morning. I had some quick announcements, but that list has grown longer. So I'll go over those as quickly as I can, and we'll go to the Lord in prayer, and then we'll have some video announcements. Just want to remind everyone to continue to social distance, to wear your mask. If you feel comfortable with that, we have hand sanitizers in the back and in the lobby. And I think it's just important that we continue to do the things we've been doing as a church over the last several months, continuing to stay healthy and safe. Right after service, if you are interested in church security, please see Larry Martin. He has some couple things he wants to go over and just find out who may be interested in doing that. We have youth again, as Pastor mentioned, at 5:30 tonight. Also, I would like to mention a cool movie that is out. We haven't gone to see it yet, but it's called My Brother's Crossing. It is currently playing at the Regal Theater, so some of our members have been to see that and have really enjoyed that, so just wanted to let everybody know that that movie is playing at Regal. I think it's important that we support those Christian movies as much as possible. That also reminds me that on October 8th at the Starlight Inn, Casting Crowns will be here in concert. So if you guys are interested in that, if you know anything about Casting Crowns, they are a wonderful group. We sing their songs here about a couple of times a month. So they are a great group. Mark Hall is wonderful at that. So they will be here live in concert at Starlight. Also, in the back, as you know, we have our offering buckets for you to drop any tithes or any gifts that you may have. And we have connect cards in the back for our guests if we'd like to connect with you. And or if you're a member, any kind of prayer request you have, you can use those connect cards to get in contact with us with any prayer requests that you have. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear God, we thank you for giving us the freedom and the ability to be here this morning to worship and hear your word. Lord, I pray for our church family, for those that are here, for those that may be traveling today. We just pray that you keep them all safe and healthy. I pray for our tithings and the offering. May we bring it to you today. Lord, may you multiply it and use it for your glory. Lord, we pray for our pastor that you allow him and give him the wisdom and knowledge to bring your message, your word, through him, Lord. Lord, may he reach those that need you, that need to hear your word, either here, online, or in other places. Lord, we just thank you for everything you give us and your blessings. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Welcome to Good Shepherd Baptist Church. We're glad you're here. If you forgot your Bible today, you can join us on the Bible app, where you can follow along, take notes, and reference the Bible. You can find Good Shepherd Baptist Church under Bible App Events. Our church is now accepting donations for Christmas blessing bags. There are many items that we would love to give on behalf of GSBC, and we plan to pack them in the first part of November. You can leave items on the left side of the Welcome Center where the school supply drop box was. If you would like to see what you can donate, please check the GSBC Family Life handout or contact Dee Wallace for questions. Our church is accepting donations of canned vegetables and mac and cheese for the Montgomery County Christmas store until October 25th. You can leave donations in the shopping cart on the right side of the Welcome Center. Senior Saints are planning to meet regularly on the first and third Thursdays of each month at 10 a.m. The next meeting is set for October 1st. Please contact Shirley Williams for questions. Youth ages 6th grade and up are welcome to join us from 5:30 to 8:30 on Sunday evenings, where we learn how to train and disciple others. Good Shepherd's Women of the Word will gather October 1st at 6:30 p.m. for a night of fellowship. For more information, please contact Dee Wallace. The Lord loves a cheerful giver. You can continue to give tithes and offerings in the offering buckets in the back of the worship center by mailing your giving into our P.O. box, through the Tithely mobile app, or through our website at gsbcfamily.org/give. There is power in prayer. If you or someone you know needs prayer, please submit a prayer request through the offering bucket, through our website, or by speaking with church leadership. If you are ready to take the next step in sharing your faith by being baptized with water, we want to be there and help you make it happen. Let a church leader know so we can get you signed up. Stay connected with our church emails and phone calls so you don't miss any updates throughout the week. If you're ready to make the commitment to become a church member, let us know so we can take you through the Discovering Church membership class. Help us spread the word about our church by leaving helpful Google and Facebook reviews. This will help people find us and learn about who we are more easily. We still care about keeping our church and community healthy and safe. Please help us by wearing your masks, sanitizing, and staying physically distanced when possible.
Thanks for watching. Now
you are in the know.
The prisoner and the soldier.
to the young and to the older, all who hunger, all who thirst, all the last and all the first, all the paupers and the princes, all who failed, you've been forgiven,
all who dream and all who suffer, all who loved and lost another, all the tame and all the free, all who follow, all who lead, anyone who's been let down, all the lost you have been found, all who've been labeled right or wrong, to everyone who hears this song.
Still know
it well with your soul this morning? If it's not, it can be today. And that's the hope we have. If you have your Bibles, turn to Ephesians 1. You can find it on your phones. It'll also be on the screen briefly. But I think it's so important to have a copy of God's Word in your hand today. And the more we can see it, the more we will believe and understand it. But I've been in a series the last few weeks about seeing who Jesus is. And we're in Ephesians 1. It's just amazing how it lays it out for us. And I'm going to be honest, today is so important. And here's why. Here's why today is important. Because today is how we're going to do what I've shared with you the last few weeks. The Scripture tells us who we are in Christ. We're chosen, we're wanted, we're adopted, we're secure, we're complete, we're competent, we're all these things. But yet, let's just be honest. We can sing, "It is well with my soul," but is it well with your mind? Was it well with your mind this week? Anybody struggle with your thoughts? Come on, let's see those hands. My hand's up. Come on. Anybody worry, have doubts, have fears? Yeah. Anybody struggle with your choices? Anybody have some choices they wish they could take back? Do-overs. How about your emotions? I see those hands. It's dangerous to raise your hand in a Baptist church, so I see those hands. They're talking about Hurricane Sally. They'd do it all over again. They wouldn't be there. But how about your emotions? Anybody just struggling with some maybe being down and worry and all those things? Well, today, again, is how we're going to do the why. And then also I'm going to finish with the what. But I think just kind of a quick review. Today we're going to look at how you are complete in Christ. The next slide, this has kind of been one of our theme verses. It's found in Romans chapter 12, verse 3. It says, "By the grace given me, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought." Each one of us today has these mirrors from our past that give us a sense of who we are. We have mirrors of our performance and things going on in our lives and our looks and our abilities. And sometimes those mirrors can become warped and we have a warped sense of who we are. And then we come and we hear, "Pastor, you're just hammering us with who we are, but I just don't get it." Well, don't think too highly of yourself. And also on the flip side, don't think too low of yourself. Our formula was this, where we get our identity, our self-worth. The formula was others' opinions plus performance equals our self-worth. And you remember our coping mechanisms? Our coping mechanisms are one, either compulsion. You're just a perfectionist. You're overdriven. You're just a workaholic. You're all about your looks and you're in all those things to try to find your self-worth. And then some of us withdraw. Well, I'm afraid of rejection. I'm not going to do anything because they might, you know, just not want me or whatever it is. And sometimes we can vacillate between the two. Galatians 1:10 says this. It says, "And now," look to the screen, and says, "Now, trying to win the favor and approval of men or God." Am I now trying to win the favor and approval of men or of God? Am I seeking to please someone? If I were still trying to be popular with men, I would not be a bondservant of Christ. Paul wrote that to the church at Galatia, but it's true for us today, 2,000 years ago. We're just so driven on what other people think. And I'm just going to give you some of the barriers today to why we don't really understand these truths. And today we're just going to try to move these things 18 inches from our head to our heart just a little bit more. But here it is, based on our feelings, we feel inadequate. You just don't measure up. We feel hopeless. We feel lonely. We've talked about that in COVID-19, how easy it is to feel that way. We feel abandoned. We feel guilt. And I think one of the biggest barriers we're going to talk about today that hinders us from seeing who we are in Christ is shame. Shame. The definition of shame is a painful feeling of regret, self-hate, and dishonor. Shame usually results in guilt and self-deprecation, but it can also lead us to search for God and answers. So shame was actually the first emotion really felt in the garden. Go back to Genesis 3. And I love it. We kind of see a parenting tactic there. God says, where are you guys? He asks a question, and, you know, where are you? And of course, you know, the first game of hide-and-go-seek. Any kids in here love to play hide-and-go-seek? Even some of our youth love to play hide-and-go-seek. Even some of our adults, I see those hands, love to play hide-and-go-seek. They were playing hide-and-go-seek from God, and you just can't win with God playing hide-and-go-seek. And he asks them a question. He said, how did you know this? How did you know that you were naked? Where are you getting this shame? The second question, he wants them to face it. So he wants them to see it, but then he wants them to face it. He says, well, who told you you were naked? Face that shame. But then in God's grace, the process is this. He wants to cover that shame. And then he begins to forgive us when we repent, and he repairs us and heals us. But some of us are so damaged today because of our emotions. Shame can be a tough thing. I call it kind of an imprint. Maybe your family, some of you had great childhoods growing up, some of you didn't. Maybe some of you knew your father or didn't have a close relationship with your mother, and those imprints of our parents can lead to shame. Maybe it was a teacher. One of our kids, we had a coach that just tried to encourage but just berated in sports, and that shaped one of our children's view of athletics. Maybe it was a peer, you know. Maybe you weren't the popular kid. Maybe you were, I wasn't. I was popular up until fourth grade. And then after that, things, the world kind of crept into the relationships, and I took a different path as a follower of Christ, even in fourth grade. Maybe it was a boss. Maybe you had a harsh boss or a coworker, and you're just wrapped here today with these feelings and emotions of shame, and you just, for the last 10, 20, 30 years, you're trying to overcome that shame. And let me just say, I'm going to touch on a nerve here. Maybe it was something that was done to you. Pastor, now you're messing. Maybe something, you were the victim of something, and then maybe you were the one who caused that. Maybe you were the one that did something to someone, and there's just this shame, this barrier that you can't overcome. You're living and trying to cope with that. Well, if that's you today, there's good news. And let's look at it in Ephesians 1, starting in verse 15. It says this. For this reason, I too, Paul's writing here, he says, having heard of the faith in the Lord Jesus which exists among you and your love for all the saints. Just let's pause right there. We just dropped in. If this is your first time, you're joining us online. Paul has been trying to tell us who we are in Christ. As a child of God, this is your new identity. And then he begins to shift to this prayer. And it's going to be a focus of our lesson today and how we're going to move this truth of our identity from our heads to our hearts and to our practice. And he's praying for them, and he says in verse 16, it says, and do not cease giving thanks for you while making mention of you in my prayers. Don't you love a praying pastor? I pray for you. I pray for you throughout the week. I pray for our church in general. Some of you have shared some things. I've been praying for some of your grandkids. Been praying for some of the things that you shared with me. And that's what Paul is doing. He's writing here, and he says, I just thank the Lord that you love other saints, and I just want you to know I'm praying for you. Is prayer important? How important is prayer? Does anybody here feel like you've arrived, though, in your prayer life? I shared with our senior saints this last Thursday. We had a great time in the chapel. How my grandfather, my mother's father, was a prayer warrior. He prayed for, he had a bunch of grandkids, and he prayed for us by name daily. How many of you pray for your kids daily? Let me see those hands. How many of you pray for your grandkids daily? That's so important. Prayer is so important. Paul is belaboring that point here, and he says, guys, I'm so thankful for you. Now watch here in verse 17. Here's the prayer. Watch what it says. This is the key to understanding and kind of unlocking all the previous verses. He says, I pray that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give to you a spirit of wisdom and of revelation, and here it's in the knowledge of Him. Verse 18, I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened so that you will know what is the hope of His calling, what are the riches of the glory of His inheritance in the saints. And here it is, verse 19, and what is the surpassing greatness of His power toward who? Toward us who believe. These are in accordance with the working of the strength of His might. We'll come back. Let's pause right there. The first thing I want you to see this morning is that Paul is praying for this journey, for this truth to move of who they are in Christ, 18 inches. And he prays there in verse 17. Look at it again. He says that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, that's an interesting theological term there, just quickly. Some religions, and they're false religions, they're the ones that come usually on Saturday morning. They don't believe that Jesus is God. They believe He's God's Son, but they don't believe He's also God. And what Paul is doing here is he's connecting the deity. He says that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, he's connecting God and the Son as one. Of course, we know the Trinity is what? God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. All are one. And again, other false religions, they come and they say, well, no, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was a lowercase g God. That's false doctrine. You could take him to this scripture right here. He's linking what I'm praying to and who I'm praying to is God and the Father, and they are one. And then here's what he says, verse 17. I'm praying to the Trinity that they may give to you a spirit of wisdom and of revelation. I don't know about you, but I think so often in churches we can just get information, information, information. We can get so much knowledge, knowledge, knowledge. And the school system will tell you knowledge is power. Do you remember that slogan? Knowledge is power. Well, I know some people that have a lot of knowledge, but they don't know how to put it into practice. And that's what wisdom is. It's taking that knowledge and putting it into practice, and it's through a biblical worldview or a lens of what the Scripture teaches us. Paul is literally praying, and I don't know about you, but if these truths are not moving from your head to your heart, I can tell you I have wrestled with this all week praying for you guys. In tears this morning, praying that God would illuminate and enlighten these truths from your head to your heart. Because God says you're wonderful and the world says you're terrible. God says you're amazing, I chose you, and the world says I don't care anything about you. And we have this competing worldview swirling around in our heads, and it doesn't move to our heart. And I had the head knowledge of this for about 30 years. Let me say it again. I had a head knowledge of this for about 30 years. But I remember when the light bulb came on, and now it's beginning, it's still a work in progress. It's still beginning to flesh out from my head to my heart to my hands to my lifestyle. Paul's praying for that journey for his faithful flock in Ephesus, and he's praying that they would know this truth and it would move from their heads to their hearts. Yes or no, it's easy to get a head knowledge of Jesus, yes or no? You go out and you know who Jesus is? Yeah, well, I believe in Jesus and I go to church and all those things are great. But do you have a heart knowledge of Him as well? You've heard me say this before. Who's the President of the United States, church? Come on, who's the President of the United States? Yeah. Where does he live? White House, 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue. What's he drive? Well, he doesn't drive. He's got a motorcade. But has anybody here ever really met the president? Now, somebody, anybody shaking the hands of the president or previous presidents? No? Here's the difference. We can have such a head knowledge and know everything about where our president's from, but if we don't have a personal relationship with him, it's just like knowing all these things about God. You could have scripture memorized. You could go to church. You could give your money. But if you don't know him personally, you're not born again and in a relationship with him. I think so often we get information, but what we're missing in the church today, watch this, is transformation. A lot of head knowledge. But there's a difference when he begins to transform these truths into our hearts and we begin to live them out and apply them. Paul prays for their journey. The second thing I want you to see this morning is for the eyes of their hearts to be enlightened. Look again at verse 18. It says this. He says, I pray, and Keegan read this at the opening of our worship, I pray that the eyes of your hearts, open the eyes of my heart, Lord. How many love that song? What is it saying? Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see. How many of you want to see Jesus this morning? How many of you need to see him? I was singing, I need to see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. You see, Dallas Willard, the great theologian, said this, the most important thought you have is what you think about God. Most important thought you have is what you think about God. The second most important thought you have is what you think about yourself. And I don't know, I've done studies on this. Something weird happened in the 60s. Anybody go through the 60s? Something really weird happened in the 70s. Anybody go through the 70s? The 80s were kind of weird and cool all at once, and I shared a little bit of that last week. My mom got a kick out of that and my music from the 80s, but I'll move on because she could tell some stories. But they began to say, oh, you know what, don't spank and punish your children, and all this whole self-esteem movement came in. And they began to take things away and parameters and guardrails and guidelines. And that movement, we see the what seeds were planted in the 60s and 70s, we see those seeds now growing forth to today. There's such a Marxist theology that's being blasted on us right now. And we're supposed to buy in that, hey, let's have this equal society and let's all just be equal. And Jesus comes along and says, yeah, you're equal, but it's through me. You can't have equality without Jesus, the Creator, the one who came to a woman at the well and broke down barriers that she was a different and he was different and he was a man and he weren't supposed to. And he said, I'm thirsty. Can you get me a drink? And he elevated women. We don't need a movement today to elevate women. We have what the Word says. We don't need movements today. We just need to know and teach our kids and grandkids who we are in Christ. Today, we just don't see who Jesus is. And again, these truths, I can tell you you're wanted. And everything else in your life says you're not. There's shame and there's guilt. And I can tell you you're adopted and chosen. You're blameless. You're holy. You're perfect in Christ. Remember, this is our position in Christ. This is our position. But we look at our practice and we fall down. We got to take our eyes off ourselves and put them on him. He's the author, right? He's the author of our faith. He's the finisher of our faith. Let's take our eyes off of our daily walk, our daily failures, our past shames and regrets, and let's put them on him in the truth of his word. So he prays for three things, for our eyes of our heart to be enlightened. The first one is our hope. And when I say hope, it's not wishful thinking. We hope it doesn't rain on a wedding day. That's not what I'm talking about here. We hope the Bears beat the Giants today, right, Brady, at 1 o'clock. Now, that is very wishful thinking as a Bears fan here. What this is saying is not wishful. This is saying you could take it to the bank. Verse 18 says, I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened so that you will know what is the hope of his calling. What's his calling? It's salvation. It's our daily walk with him. That's our sanctification. And one day, it's our glorification. It's the doctrine of justification. It's the doctrine of sanctification. And it's one day when we're dead in heaven as born-again believers, and we're glorified, where there's no sin, no cancer, no death, no disease, nothing. And we get a new body. Anybody excited about that? That's our hope. It's a guarantee. The second thing he prays for is our rich inheritance. Now, what's our rich inheritance? It's verse 3 through 14. Remember, it's one long run-on sentence in the original Greek language. This is who you are. This is who you are to think of yourselves. This is, you're so rich. What we don't know, child of God, is that spiritually we are multi-trillionaires. We're sitting on a wealth of who Jesus says, the inheritance we have, and yet we live like we're poor, like spiritual orphans. Think of this. You're out in Colorado, and it's wintertime, and your car heater just broke. Is anybody cold this morning? It was kind of a little chilly today, wasn't it? You're coming, your car's beginning to sputter, and you're coming to a place that's late at night, and you're lost, and you don't know where you are, and your car dies, the heater's dead, and it's snowing outside, and it just seems like all hope is lost, and you look up, and there you see a nice motel, and maybe let's throw in a Cracker Barrel. Anybody want to throw in a Cracker Barrel? Any Cracker Barrel? Where's my peeps out there? Come on now. And you reach for your wallet, and you probably never do this. And, oh. And out of the corner of your eye, you look, Keegan, and there is an automated teller machine. Whew. And you go over and you pull out your debit card and you stick it in and you check your balance. And it says that you are a billionaire. Wow. All my troubles are gone. Now I can order, I can buy the whole Cracker Barrel if I want to. I can stay here. I can get a new car with a heater and all my troubles are gone. But if you know anything about an ATM, there's a daily what? A daily limit. And this is what it's talking about here. We're supposed to take daily withdrawals. You know, you put it in. I love that sound. And you reach in. And you take these truths and you deposit them and you use them and you practice them. We are so rich spiritually that I don't really think any of us in here, including your preacher, fully understands who we are in Christ. But I want to learn. I daily deposit from this truth. If you're not in God's word, these truths really aren't going to move from your head to your heart to your practice. The third thing he prays is for his great power he offers. I'm going to come back to that in just a minute there in verse 18. The next slide, John 1:12 says this. Look to the screen. It says, "But as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, even to those who believe in his name, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor the will of man, but were born of God." That's why we call ourselves born-again Christians. John chapter 3, Jesus said to Nicodemus, "You must be born again." So what is God's child? We've covered this. Verse 3 through 4, God's child is chosen. Next slide. God's child's adopted. He's redeemed. We're valuable. Remember how valuable we were a couple weeks ago? What was shed for you and I? The blood of Jesus. That tells you how valuable you and I are. That God would send his only son to shed his blood for us on a cross, to be the propitiation, the appeasement, the satisfaction of a holy God standing between a sinful person like you and me. We're secure, and today we're learning that we are complete. As his child of God, we're complete. But look at this. Remember this picture? We had a little fun with pictures last week. Remember this one? Is that a goat or a bird? You see, sometimes we can look at these truths, and we just don't really get it, but how many of you see a goat there? Anybody see a goat? Okay. Anybody see a bird? Okay. Go to the next slide. What is it actually? It's a bird. But I still look at it and I see a goat. Okay. And that's true. We can look at this truth and it's talking about a bird and all we see is a goat. And we can get so bogged down in the theology. And listen, I'm all about doctrine. We covered that last week. I told you that there's 33 things doctrinally that happen to you and I at the moment of salvation. I've taught through all 33 things of those on a Wednesday night before, and we may walk through some of those. But the moment of salvation, 33 things happen. We have no clue. But it's truth, amen? What God says is true. The third thing and last thing I want you to see this morning is, how do we overcome this shame? How do we overcome this shame? Well, there's three things. The first one, say it with me, receive Christ. Try it again. What's the first thing? Receive Christ. If you're here today and you're not a child of God, then you're an enemy of God. Bottom line, 1 John 3 says that. You're a child of disobedience. You're not born again. You're actually dead in your sins and trespasses. You're in the domain of darkness. And by the grace of God, when He reveals Himself to us and we pray and repent and trust in a person, then we transfer out of darkness and death and a domain into light, and we're alive and we're made new. If you're here today and you may know more about this than I do. But if God's never converted you through your confession and repentance and transformed you, then you're lost. So first way we get overcome our shame is to receive Christ. The second one, say it with me, ask the Father. In fact, I want you to do this right now. I know some of you are tired. This is dangerous. I want you to close your eyes right now, and I want you to pray right now and ask the Father to reveal these truths and move them from your head to your heart to your practice. I'm going to give you 30 seconds. Paul wrote it. We're going to actually do it right now. Pray and ask Him to show you these truths in your life. Go. Heavenly Father, I thank You that even though most of us have been either compulsive or withdrawn in this process, Lord, Your truth tells us a different story. And God, I pray You, as I've prayed this week, the last couple weeks, that You would just enlighten, as Paul prayed, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, that You would enlighten and illuminate these truths in our hearts, to move them from our heads to our minds. Continue to do that in the next few minutes that we have left. We pray now in Jesus' name. Amen. Look to your neighbor. Say, are you awake? Did you go to sleep? Okay. If we were in my youth right now, I'd have you stand up, and we did jumping jacks Wednesday night. I won't make you do that right now, so don't worry. Ask the Father. Listen, if this doesn't jive and you're so caught up in your guilt and shame and your past, ask the Father to take those things away from you and begin to move them and begin to practice them. Romans 12:2 says to renew your mind, to transform it so that we can not be conformed to what the world says, but we can be conformed to what the Word says. And the last thing, how do we overcome shame? Is just to believe it. Believe the doctrine. We sang that this morning. Believe it. Reckon it to be true. Paul over and over said, don't you know? Don't you believe this? Don't you see? Can't you? This is so basic. And yet in today's society, this is so foreign. And we can't get through to this truth because of the feelings, shame, and guilt that are holding us back. So what are we supposed to believe? Here's three things. My past no longer defines me. Amen? Come on. My past no longer defines me. Well, Pastor, you don't know what goes on in my head. Yeah, I do. The devil brings up your mistakes from the past. You just remind, that's done. That's washed under the blood. We are covered. We're set free. Now, I'm going to just throw this out there. Some of you are dealing with some hurts, and what do we do with shame? We try to just kind of bury it. had a conversation with a family member recently that, you know, we didn't talk about these things back in the 70s, 80s. We just kind of, don't we just kind of sweep things under the rug? And every single one of our children grow up and they're looking to find out who they are. And if you can't throw a baseball or you can't get good grades or you're not good looking and you can't play an instrument or you're trying to overcome, and Jesus comes along and says, no, I created you. I get to define you. And we can't seem to last. Second thing, my future's guaranteed. Aren't you thankful that our future, he's the author and the finisher of our faith? Did Jesus come the first time, yes or no? Is he coming back a second time, yes or no? It's 100% likely he came the first time. That's Christmas. It's 100% likely he's coming back. And he says in his word that he wants to be with us forever. He chose you, he wanted you, he died for you so that you could be reconciled back to him. We were born separated in our sin. Sin separates. God reconciles, and he has guaranteed. Last week, do you remember what the down payment was? It was the Holy Spirit. The down payment for this promise was the Holy Spirit himself. We can take that to the bank. And then lastly, I have his power to overcome sin and challenges. If you're struggling with sin, you've got a habit you can't break, whether that's lust or anger or worry or doubt or whatever it is, it's because, according to Scripture, you don't understand who you are in Christ. Look quickly, verse 19. It says, and what is the surpassing greatness of his power toward us who believe? These are in accordance with the working of the strength of his might. This is not about us, it's about him. And then look at verse 20, which he brought about in Christ. And guess what, remember? Let's see who's paying attention. Who does this represent, church? Us. Who does this represent? Christ. We're born dead, separated. But when we repent and confess our sins, we become in Christ. And that's what verse 3 through 14. Paul's saying this is truth. And wherever Christ went, when he died on the cross, we died with him. When he went in the tomb, we went with him. And when he rose again, we rose with him. And we'll see in Ephesians 2 that now we're seated with him positionally in heaven, but we're struggling with our practice. Take your eyes off your practice and put it on your position in Christ. I want to show you a quick video. Give the guys a second, of this truth. You prayed just a few minutes ago. I've been praying for you for this to move. I want you to dial into this video. It's truth whether you believe it or not. Let's take a look at the screen. All right. Having a little technical difficulties. Anybody ever have technical difficulties at work, home? We just got internet for the first time in our house, and it's satellite internet. Woohoo! Satellite internet. That's a lot of fun. But let's go on to the next slide, and guys, you just give me a wave back there when we get it going. But I want to look at the process, okay? The process. Any Alabama Roll Tide fans in here? Okay. You go get them. All right. Any Auburn fans? Okay. I see a few hands there. Well, the coach of Alabama said, listen, just trust the process. Great coach. Just trust the process. These kids come in, if you just trust the process. He tells the coaches, trust the process. He tells the players, trust the process. He tells the fans, just let us just trust the process. And here's the process. Verse 3 through 14 is the what? And what's it tell us? We're blessed. Everybody say, I'm blessed. Look at your neighbor right now and say, you're blessed. The process, the how is verse 17. It's the praying through this. It's prayer for it to move from our heads to our hearts. I challenge you this week, pray so your pastor can move on. Some of you are like, pastor, you need to move on. Well, I'm moving on three verses, four verses at a time until you get it. I want you to get this. Why? Why is this so important? It's because of the power. It goes on to say that the same power that raised Jesus from the dead, how powerful was God when he just spoke and his son came back to life? And it goes on to say it lives in us. It lives in us. The same power. But yet, and the Greek word there is dynamos, where we get our word dynamite. And yet so many of us are just fizzling out for the Lord. When the Holy Spirit indwells us at the moment of salvation, we have the same power in us that raised Jesus from the dead. That should be something. And if we don't understand who he's telling us to be, and we don't pray for this to open the eyes of our heart to move down, no wonder we're caught in sin. No wonder we're struggling. No wonder we're in addictions. No wonder we've looked for other things to fulfill our brokenness, and we can't get out of it because we're missing the process. Who I am in Christ. How? Pray that it moves. And the why? So we have his power. You ever try to live in your own power? All right. Let's watch the screens here as we wrap up this morning. Anybody seeing this in a different way? Would you just wave your hand just a little, just quickly? I'm seeing this a little differently. Yeah. Well, what do we do? If you're here today and you don't know the Lord, you're not a child of God. What you do is you confess that. I'm separated from you, God, in my sin. And I'm tired of my sin and myself, and I'm going to turn, repent, and trust you and what you did for me on the cross. It's really that simple. You're not saying a prayer. You're not trusting in a prayer. You're trusting in a person. But I'm talking primarily to the believer this morning. You just, in a moment when we stand, you ask the Father, reveal these things to me. Move them more from my head to my heart, and then just believe it. We're going to stand to our feet. The praise team's coming. We're going to give you an opportunity to respond right now. Maybe you want to come and kneel. Maybe you want to speak to me. Maybe you can't kneel and want to just come to the front chairs here. But let's do business with God. Let's be obedient to the things He has spoken to us about this morning. Just bow your heads right now. Close your eyes. Let's just stay in the Spirit for a moment. If you're here today and your heart's pounding, you know you're separated and lost from Christ, you come. You set aside your pride and you come. You grab the hand of the person next to you and say, go up with me. For the believer, you pray. Ask God to show these truths, apply them to your life. My past doesn't define me. Jesus does. Just as you are, He loves you. He wants you. He chose you. He adopted you. You're complete in Him. Your shame can be gone. Let's sing this together this morning. You come just as you are.
Just as I am.
Just raise your hands this morning and surrender. Lift it up and give it to God. Raise your hands. children of God said, amen. Let's praise the Lord this morning. Let's give him a hand. Well, I'm so honored that you're here today, and thank you for those online joining us. And we've got a message. It wasn't my message, it was his message, amen. And the Word of God and the Spirit of God speaks, and now we get the privilege to go live it out and share it with those around. If I can help you in any way, whether it's baptism, probably next Sunday, we've got some new members to present next Sunday, and looking forward to that. I just love what God's doing in our church, and I'm thankful for his Spirit and his movement. And with that, let's bow our heads, pray, and we'll be dismissed. Father, thank you that our shame and guilt was taken care of at the cross. As your children, we no longer or should no longer carry that. Thank you that we're complete in you. We're secure, we're loved, we're wanted, we're chosen. God, may you continue to drive that from our heads to our hearts and to our lifestyle. Bless each one that's here today. Give us a great week to share you with those around us, we pray now in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. You're dismissed.